Good afternoon, everybody. Introducing Bala is embarrassing him like hell. He kept telling me, make it simple. I and Bala go back, I think, as long as I have been in journalism. He's been one of my earliest sources when he was in CRISIL. And CRISIL had just started at that time. So the concept of credit rating itself, even for companies, now even we individuals are credit rated and, you know, our borrowing performance is tracked. But those were the days when even companies didn't believe in credit rating. And he helped set up CRISIL along with Pradeep Shah. And not only did he help set up CRISIL, I remember he went to Malaysia to set up the Malaysian Credit Bureau for the first time. It was the first time they were launching it. After that, Bala has been in various top organizations. He's been heading research for DSP Merrill Lynch when it was with Merrill Lynch. And he's worked with almost, he's been a fund manager. He was with... He's been with First India Mutual Fund as the CEO and CIO. He's been with Sahara. He's been with Edelweiss. And he hates us going into details about what he's done and all the different kinds of experience. But what it all boils down to is from the stock market, where he used to be very active, apparently, even before CRISIL. This is before I knew him. So this is all stories that we hear about what Bala knew about the market and how speculators used to operate in the days of open outcry systems. To every bit of research and rating that you can get, you cannot possibly have a better speaker talking about what to do and how to choose your stocks carefully and safely. So with these few words, I hand over the mic to Bala.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Sarah, and thank you, Sujata. I think Sujata has very embarrassed me very deeply. I didn't realize I'm so old. And you see, what I think this title, there is a caution I must attach to that. That word safely is very relative. Okay. Nobody has yet found it. I wish I could still find it. And I'm still learning, I think. What we do is we read a lot, we talk to people a lot, we meet them a lot. So books are the infinite source as far as I am concerned. So if there are some books on sale, please grab them, I would say. The topic is was given to me was to explain ratios. I don't know whether the audience here really wants to go into each and every ratio and really understand, because a classroom is not a right place. So what I thought was I will go into some of the ratios, what they mean. There are one or two of them which probably we should be looking. So what happens is we use financial ratios as a one more tool. See, when you are going to pick an investment, there is no one science or one formula by which you can say this is a stock, I must buy this and this will go three times. If it was doing all those things, I don't think I'll be here talking to y'all. We are still trying to find that magic. What works? So let's go back to the beginning. What are we doing when we are buying a share? Do you have any idea? 9 out of 10 people think it is the quickest way to make money. And it is a quick way to make unearned money. Unearned because you don't work for it. You buy it at a price and somebody else buys it at a higher price. Correct? Have you added any value to it? Have you worked on it? No. Have I worked on it? No. Nobody has worked. So here, what are we trying to do when we are buying a share? Very easy, because it's very difficult answer to give if I tell you, you bought 100 shares of Tata. What does it mean? It means nothing. But assume tomorrow that there is a newly started company and you are buying all the shares in that company. It has got only 100 shares. Does it change anything for you? You become the owner. Correct? And you may either run it or you may have a manager run it. Correct? So what do you do when you buy 100 shares of Tata's? You are a part owner and you are trying to say that Tata's is a good manager, I trust him. That is the one way to look at when you invest in shares. Now your attitude to investing will change, because now you started thinking beyond price. Otherwise, I am saying I buy at 80s, the guy has told me to buy, it will go to 100. Okay, after a few days, I find it goes to 95, I am wait for 100. And then 70, it's a long-term investment now. So this is how we, all of us, accumulate so many shares. So this is one approach I take. Then second, why do I put money into shares at all? Sorry?
Hedge against inflation.
Any other reason? Or what is the logic behind putting money into shares or into somebody's business?
Earning profits.
Dividend is tax free, whatever. So what you're actually looking for it, that this businessman on the rupee you invest will make more returns than what you can earn by keeping it in a bank. Am I right? Okay, the stock market is only an indicator of price, and the price is decided by so many different things. Today the stock price of a bank called Axis Bank went up 13%. You know the logic?
Yeah.
Because the FII limit was increased. Has it changed anything in the bank? Nothing. It is only you think you got a new bakra to buy that. There was nothing which changed in that. But before you invest into Axis Bank, what should you have thought? Saying that, yes, that bank is going to make more money than keeping money in the bank deposit. So there are measures for that. So what do you do when you see a balance sheet? See, a balance sheet is a piece of history. It is a static record. You don't know what is going on in the company. You don't know. Somebody is giving you a snapshot. You have a balance sheet, which is a statement of recorded assets and balance sheets as given by the management, and on that basis the auditor certifies it, saying this is this, and you get it on September 30th. Nowadays you don't even get to read it because it's on your email, correct? So 9 out of 10 people don't read it. Let me be very clear. So even if it was in a physical copy, if you are getting bored, your wife is shouting at you, you'll bury your head into that. But today you don't read that. So one is you're getting it 6 months later as to what they had. So many things on the basis of somebody else. And then you have a profit and loss account, which is again a summary of what happened during the year. It doesn't tell you who the customers are, did they get new customers, did they lose any customers, nothing. So it is again an approximate state of financial health. And what do you trust? After Satyam, you don't even trust whether the cash balance is right in that. Correct?
Bank FD.
Bank FD. So you see a balance sheet. So ultimately, what the balance sheet doesn't make sense to us. And what is ratio of what I do as financial analysis? There is a numerator, there is a denominator. So I can take any number at random, put it on top, put it on bottom, I got a new ratio. Correct? So we have, actually there are only two or three very relevant ratios. All the rest are more complexities to justify the existence of analysts like me. Otherwise we wouldn't have work. We will have to say that this is a very exotic ratio, things like that. The financial analysis part is very simple. But before that, the homework you do on what are you buying, what is the company doing, what the management is, I think they become very relevant. Because what happens is, in the balance sheet there is a profit which is reported. Now that profit is attributable to all shareholders, correct? And whoever has how many number of shares, proportionately you say that's my share, my profit. But the promoter, is he thinking the same way? He has so many ways of taking out money from the company, so his return on investment is far greater than what you and I will get. So this is a constant battle, whether it's US, India, everywhere it's the same. It's not that only India, because we are in India, we see Indians. If you go there, we'll see the Americans doing the same thing. So there's always a question of trust. So there is a question of faith. You trust somebody and put money in it, saying that both of us are on the same platform, that is to increase the value of this share. So if the promoter is having the same goal, I am happy to be with him. And I look at the business. I look at whether this business will stay 5 years, 10 years into the future. Do I understand it a bit? Or so most of us don't think about what shares we are buying. It is most often we think deeply for about a month or so that I have to invest. You take serious interest, study about 20 research reports, some economic times, everything you read. finally, when you actually take the call, it will be based on the last tip you got. You analyze your investment decisions and see where it is. Most probably, 9 out of 10 cases, it will be like that. You don't make a short list or a homework and say, I want to learn, then I will make a short list, and after that, at my prices, I will buy or sell. Sorry?
On this thing of business and promoters, give us the example of Bartronics, which was a very fancy stock at one time, and how you analyze, you wrote about it.
Yeah. See, Bartronics, this is where the analysis or the number checks comes up. I was with a friend of mine who was a fund manager. There was an annual report lying on his table. I said, Bartronics. I said, let me understand that company. It was a new company for me. The stock was trading at some 320 rupees or something like that. He said, do you need the thing? He said, nahi, mujhe zarurat nahi yaar, kisi ne broker ne bola, main le liya fund mein, abhi 40 rupiya upar ho gaya hai. Bola, acha hai. So, I travel a lot, so there's a lot of time to read. So I started reading that thing, annual report. Kya bana de? They make those barcode labels. He said, barcode labels mein itna paisa kahan se bana sakta hai? It's a commodity item. You can, and it is sold by the weight. It's not even sold by the numbers. Kind of a commodity. Then I started looking at the numbers. I have lived with numbers from my class 9, so numbers talk to me, so it's interesting. I started looking at the inconsistencies in that. His debtors under 6 months. Do you understand?
Yes.
That is money which has to be collected for sales made within the last 6 months. Were far higher than the sales he showed in the last 6 months. So it set me off. And I started going into the balance sheet. I didn't go beyond the balance sheet. I did not talk to anybody. And there are about 8 or 10 such inconsistencies which showed up. I called my friend. I said, you sell that share pehle. Kya ho gaya? Aisa aisa hai. We were colleagues at CRISIL and he had forgotten to analyze the balance sheet. Because he had become a capital market animal, ki jo hai price is what he is trading in, he is not trading in stocks. Price is what. So we wrote that, we published it in Money Life. After that, there were a lot of things. I got a call from Sudhir Rao also, who was the managing director. And then they issued some clarification. Today, of course, the stock is at, I think, 5 rupees? 5 rupees or something. Because numbers ultimately will show up in the sense when there are inconsistencies. But something like Satyam, which is a very well structured fraud, that no analyst can find out. Okay, there are a lot of ways in which we do. If I spend a week with a company's balance sheets of 10 to 15 years, there are a lot of things which one can find out, but that needs years of rigorous training, inputs and things like that. And still we are not clear. We still get to, let us say, a possibility that yes, there is something wrong. But there's no way in which can prove it. So my attitude in life is I start with skepticism. One. So, and two, you, when you put money in the stock market, what are you looking at? You're looking at a return. The stock market, yes, I believe in stocks a lot. Because I think that's the only thing which will defend me against inflation. But I also know that the returns will not come when I want it. If I have chosen carefully, the returns will come, but I don't know when it will come. Because when I need that money, suppose I plan it for 3 years, I cannot in 3 years, there could be a scam, there could be a market crisis, there could be anything. When I sell, it may be half my price. Nothing would have changed in the business. My analysis may be perfectly right, but the market may not give me that price. So I have to invest with money which I really don't need at this stage. Stocks are a way to build wealth. It is not for savings, please understand.
Or income.
It gives you neither.
So the
more the questions, the better I also become.
The first thing is people sell it as a tool.
Mm-hmm.
See, for a person who's not into numbers, not having time to read all the policies,
True.
There's a guy who will walk in the door, sir, this is an investment, this is a savings, you'll get returns. So there is nothing which we can be protected about by saying this is a false sale.
Okay.
It's like these people come and say, no, you can invest in stocks, it is a good savings. There's a different approach which you're saying right now. It's a good return, but you know, there's no defined time when you'll get that return.
Exactly.
So over an aggregate of 5, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, you never know, but it will give return. Some guys say, okay, you buy a stock, put them in a safe, forget about it. Maybe after 20 years, you can open the cupboard and then see, okay, yeah, and now you made some money. Is that what it's supposed to be?
It's generally like that. I think stocks, when most investors buy, they never sell, because it is a tool for creating wealth, I believe. I think there may be people who differ. There are people who trade every day in and out, and they call themselves expert. But do you see the name of any trader in a Forbes 1 million list also? You don't.
There was one. He went to jail.
Ah. Yes. So you don't see that. It's not very easy, sir, as I understand. See, I must have invested in about 20 stocks. About 5 have gone dud. Absolutely gone dud. But the rest have given me good returns only because in 15 years I have not sold them and I have waited long enough. I'm not saying that what I did was the right thing, but it has left me free of worries. I am not like an analyst who will say, I want to measure each and every return from every asset I get. I want to put first my bucket into savings. I want to make sure about where I'm going to be. I want my liquidity. After that, money to spare, yes, stocks. Fine. So it's also a philosophy of what you're looking for from stocks. If you're looking for pure trading ideas, I think we're not there. And to mis-selling and everything, I think that's what at Money Life, Sucheta and Debu have been doing. I think we will hit our 200th issue before Sachin Tendulkar. His 200th rest. So we are at 198 now. So we've been trying for 198 fortnights to educate investors and tell them that things are not what they seem. And this is the effort we are taking, and this is part of that effort. And nobody tells you, and nobody reads the right books. All you got to read is 2 books on investing, and that should be enough. You don't need to watch CNBC, read Economic Times. They are the ones which make you lose money because they are driven by brokers who need money every day. You read Benjamin Graham, but then you read the first page, you'll go to sleep. So I think investment is also not, it's not just a science or pure number work. It's also a liberal art in the sense that prices are decided by so many things which are unknown to us, not controlled by us. What a good financial analysis can do is help you make a nice short list, give you a range of what is right price, wrong price for it. It's like, for example, if you're getting an 8%, I always use this analogy. I think on the government or a fixed deposit, you're getting 8%. That means 100 rupees you give, you get 8 rupees. So which is your ROI or ROE, whichever way you look at it. So you look at what are the earnings and what you are willing to pay. But stocks don't have static earnings. So it becomes more challenging. How much earnings will grow? How much will it grow? And every research report you read seems to say that whatever stocks they recommend is growing at 30% permanently. That means our GDP should be at 20%. But we don't see that. So what we again do, I tell people to do is, you take a company and look at 10-year record, last 10 years. It would cover at least one business cycle. Take out the worst year and the best year, take the averages. So the average is somewhere close to that. So you take that as a kind of a base performance. And then you say that based on that, the stock today is worth so much. So I am willing to pay something less than that so that I have a return. So there are complex models which can be built, or you can have your numbers put in and everything. But finally, I think it will all boil down to what our expectations, what our patience is. So if you, again, to coming back to your question, I think timing, there is no guarantee of when you want to buy. When you want to sell. When you want to buy is in your control. We all end up buying when there is maximum noise in the street. Correct? And that's the time, I think, when prices are high, everybody is happy. I think. But we forget to sell because our happiness is not completed. So today I just want to take you through one company's balance sheet. I will not go through too many complex ratios. The sheet will be a little scary for people to look at because it's 10 years of numbers with ratios and everything. So I'll just come back to three things again in ratio analysis. What I look at in a balance sheet or in a company financials can be divided into three groups. One is I will divide the data sets into earnings. That is measures for comparing the income or the revenue. How do I measure the income of a company? The second is I want to study the balance sheet in terms of what assets liabilities are. And third is what I call as the cash flow, because cash is what I think is real till we saw Satyam. There also I am proved that it's not real, so I have to take a call. I think Infosys with Narayan Murthy and everybody, maybe yes, they have cash. Tata's, they have cash. Others, I am not so sure. So it's that kind of a thing. And then there will be a lot of checklists and things like that which over experience you will get. You know, a good company, if it makes so much money, why doesn't it give dividend? You will start questioning. So these are things you must... Sorry?
Or pay tax.
If somebody is paying only 10% tax or no tax at all, that means in his income tax books he's in a loss. So he's only showing some accounting manipulations to show an image and then raising more and more money from the market. I'll tell you the example of Opto Circuits, which was a favorite of the darlings. About 2 years ago, I started looking at the annual reports of that company for 10 years. And what I found was very scary. In 10 years, that company had bought 15 companies. Now, to my knowledge, not even a single acquisition in the world has worked well. Even if you acquire one, what happens is either that business is shut down or it ends up killing this business also. And this company in 12 years has bought 15 businesses and claims to be happy. I went deeper and deeper. Some of the things which where I smelt something wrong was they gave the number of employees and the average wages. I took out the management salaries, and the average wage for somebody in they were in medical equipments, diagnostics and all that, the average wage was 7,000 rupees a month. I said they must be less qualified than my driver to make all these medical kits. So start thinking like that. So one by one I went. Then I looked at the cash flow. Each year the cash flow was negative. The sales are growing, but so are the debtors are growing even faster. The stocks are growing even faster. So all that, at the end of the year, they had no cash. So every third year he was issuing new shares. He was surviving on that. He was paying dividends, everything. So we pointed this out. About a year ago, finally people realized, and now that share is from again some 600 it had gone to, it's come down to 25 rupees, 23 rupees. But these are frauds. They can be sustained for long periods, believe me, this kind of frauds. So it's important to pick companies with history and understand a bit. Okay, today you're picking up, if you want safe investing, there are always these multinational companies. They are very expensive, but you will not lose your shirt, let me tell you that. So coming back to these three measures, first let me talk about profitability, how I measure and what you should be looking at. There are a lot of numbers and these are very, very simple things which I look at. Okay. This is a company, I have taken the last 10 years performance. This is in rupees crores, this is a real company, not a case study or anything like that. So you have the sales growing from 8,000 crores to 80,000 crores. Okay. No, that's fine. Can you all see? I think it's too small at the end, but for the last few rows, I don't think they can see. Okay. But there is a sea change in 2007-08. That's because they acquired a huge company, several times bigger than themselves. So the sales shows a huge jump. And this is the first four, five lines just show the summary of where they made their money or how much they made. Okay. So what I have done is this last column shows the compound rate of growth for the last 5 years only, because from 10 years it would be misleading because it was a different structure altogether. So if you look at that, this company has been growing at 5% in terms of sales. 5% in sales is half of our inflation rate. So the real rate of growth in this company is negative. If I look at the operating profit, it has actually been declining. It's come only by, grown by only 3%. Its depreciation, again, has not grown much. The depreciation has also not grown so much. It's just about 3%. He's got some other income because they have a lot of cash in the balance sheet which they lend and make money on that. Then same way we come to the profit. The profit has grown almost in line with the sales, about 5.7% before tax. After tax, it's grown by about 6%. That's because he has paid less taxes. Okay. Then if you look at this is the again the position of assets. He's got his fixed assets, work in progress. Work in progress is 33,000 crores. You can imagine the size of what projects he's got. And each year he's got huge amount of work in progress. There's a strategy behind this, which I will come to that. So, and I come to the net worth, how he has done it. I put some basic numbers here. I don't know if you want to go into every detail, it doesn't make too much sense, but I'll come to the principle or what the thing is. What I have done is I have summarized the profit and loss and the balance sheet for the last 10 years. Last 10 years, this is what the summary is. The next sheet is what will probably help you to understand things a little better. Don't focus on the numbers, those numbers don't really matter. This company has been regular in raising money. He has raised almost every other year money from the capital markets through GDRs and private placements and everything. And this second line shows how his fixed assets he has added to fixed assets. This 2008-09 is a huge number because he bought over a global company. Was several times his own size. And then he's got work in progress. And see, this is important to me. When I look at the cash flow, what I look at is one, you make money. But to make money, how much of cash you actually lock in? You've got current assets. Current assets is basically your stocks, debtors, cash in hand, plus other current assets which may be there. Then you have current liabilities, which means your creditors give you money to finance some of those, and some other small liabilities will be there. The difference between the two is money which you actually are putting there. So the working capital, which is, that is a investment you got to make that money. So from the profits you make, there is some cash which is going to fund those kind of things. So only the balance will be available to you to meet your other obligations of interest or dividend or tax or anything like that. So you can have a situation where you have a hugely negative number because the growth in debtors may be so high that you may be actually selling on credit just to boost your sales. So on a year-on-year, what it does show is that maybe the fictitious, there was a company called Moser Bear, which I had really studied. And there the cash flow analysis showed me where the fraud was. What the company used to do was, they were selling those CD-ROMs. Remember those CDs? The printed MRP was 145 rupees. I looked at the balance sheet. In those days, you had to give the quantity and everything. So multiplied, I got an average realization per CD of 120 rupees. And in the marketplace, I also bought those CDs. They were available at 35 rupees. So I said, this guy is accounting for sales at 120 rupees. Then I looked at the debtor number was huge. What he was doing was, he would sell, let's say, 100 CDs this year. and he would invoice them at 120 rupees. Next year, he would give them a discount of 100 rupees on that. And it would come back as a selling expense. So next year, he has to show higher sales to cover that. So he will show, I sold 200, then 400, then at some stage he could not do that. So the whole thing came. But the cash flow gave the true indicator because the increase in debtors was so much, flow was becoming negative. That was much later. Yeah, and Warburg had invested it when they saw this. So, people don't do basic homework. So, after that I look at what cash is left after this current assets you put money in. So, I take this as, let's say, the cash accruals from that. From that I pay interest. Now, everybody sees interest as a number. You have got loans as a number. So now I one step and try to check that also. I'll come in the next slide on that. So this company has got 56,000 crores of debt. His average cash accrual has never crossed 6,000 to 7,000 crores. So how many years will it take to repay this without interest? Okay. But he will say in future, because he has got 33,000 crores of work in progress, on that he will earn more money. But I, given his past record, I suspect that. So he will have to either raise more capital or he will have to change the debt. And this company has a lot of global borrowings. On March 30th, whatever was the exchange rate, that's the rupee value there. So now you can imagine that debt, which was $10 million, would be probably close to about 30% higher than, 20% higher than that. And then he's got debt. Each year he's raised huge debt, 15,000, 11,000, 5,000. Then his other income is what he gets on his treasury, what he keeps in cash. He's got investments. These are basically locked into other subsidiaries where he has put capital. Because he has global operations, he has got something like 48 global subsidiaries. Okay, so I take the cash accrual, reduce the change in current assets. So this is what he had, 2,700 crores. And if I knock off depreciation as an expenditure, see, depreciation to all accountants is a non-cash item. But if I have a machinery which lasts for 10 years and I want to keep it in the same shape for 10 years, shouldn't I be investing at least that much in overhauling or renewing that? So if I take that also off, he has got negative cash flows in 2 out of 5 years. He could not even afford to renew his machinery, technically speaking. So from that I reduce dividend. In 2 out of 5 years, he has paid dividend out of borrowings and capital. So what I also do was, he had 56,000 crores of interest, and I took his interest cost as stated in his balance sheet. Understood? Yeah. I said, what is the percentage it works out to? I find that he is incredible. He has borrowed money at these kind of rates, 4%, 5%, 7%. How is it possible? Doesn't matter, but ultimately you are translating it into rupees. And global also, nobody is going to give you money at 3% and 4%. What he's done, I read the notes of the account, is that contrary to normal practice, he capitalizes interest. He adds it to asset cost, saying, I have borrowed to buy this table. Therefore, this 100 rupee table is now 100. Yeah. First is the assets. Now I start doubting whether the assets are worth what he's, and his profits are overstated. So I check that. And whereas his income, he's earning phenomenal income on his investments. And he is not investing in equities or in the national spot exchange. This is all from liquid funds and fixed deposits. So he's earned this kind of money. So there he could have easily used this interest which he got to set off those costs. No, he's not done that. He's shown his income at full level. He's hidden his expenditures. Then I looked at how much his net worth has been changed over the last 10 years. Out of that, through business, he has increased his net book value by 19,000 crores. But his total increase is 28,000 crores. So the balance has come from new issues of equity at different prices. And his tax rate, till here he was good fellow. After that, once that huge acquisition started, he started paying lesser and lesser taxes. That's because his real profits are not as much as he stated. So his tax rate is dipping. That's how he's been showing profits. I'm trying to tell you that I look at the cash flow, then there are also some stories within stories here. This is a relatively clean company, what I observed. In the industry, it's very well recognized, lot of reputation. There may be some shareholders here, I won't be surprised. Let's look at some of the ratios which is shown. His operating margin, that is his profits as a percentage of sales, is extremely poor. It has come down from 23, 24 and 22 to 9 and 10 after he took over the global acquisition. His net margin is like a trading business today, 2% and 3%. Net margin, I mean, is profit after tax to sales. Okay. Then his interest cover, because interest cover is wrong here, because I have taken as reported. But what he is doing in the interest is he is capitalizing more than half of it. So the interest cover would actually be half of this only. Okay, these two ratios are eye-openers. Return on capital employed and return on equity. What's return on capital employed? These are two ratios which I think people should understand. Return on capital employed and return on equity. This should be your first thing when you see an annual report to do. I think this does not require great skills. Needs a calculator and a piece of paper. That's all. Return on capital employed. Now, what is the capital employed in that? There are two parts to it. One is your own money, which is represented by share capital and reserves. Correct? The other one is borrowings. Correct? Total borrowings. So, add the two numbers. You got the denominator. Okay. And what should be the top number is your profit before tax plus interest. Okay. Because interest you are paying to the people who borrowed, the profit before tax comes to the shareholders whose money is the net worth. So it is a very logical ratio, very simple way to measure profits. Saying that I earn so much money before there are two sets of investors in my company. One is the lender, which is basically shown under borrowings, long term and short term. Other is the net worth of the company, which belongs to the shareholders. So the money to give them is one, I pay them interest, and the others get out of the surplus any dividend. I ignore depreciation in this. Okay. So out of these two, so logically, if you are putting money in the bank, what is it that you expect? You are getting 8% or 9%. If you are a senior citizen, ex-bank employee, you will get 10.5% today for a 5-year deposit. Okay. So, in a business, shouldn't the business be getting little more than that? A lot more than that, to my mind. Okay. This company's average is pathetic. It is 8, 7 and 6. Now, would you be running this kind of a business if you had your money to do? You wouldn't be doing it. But the promoter is doing it. Why?
Of banking.
obviously his return on his investment is coming out of this and reducing this. That is a logical explanation. Or he is a dreamer who thinks that in next year, 2 years, 3 years, I will make lots more money and then I will, my investment will pay off. That's a call he has taken. So one of the two. I'm not saying he is definitely a thief. I'm saying the possibilities he could be a thief, or the other possibilities he is expecting that this is a bad time for the industry. In 2-3 years it will recover to more than 10 or 12%. I would say that my hurdle rate for choosing ROCE is 15%, because there is also a risk involved. I take the average of 10 years and I exclude the best year and the worst year, and I see if there is 15%. Otherwise, I don't want to be an investor in that. See, as a businessman, you might have chosen to set up an airline or you might have chosen to do whatever. But as an investor, I have a choice. I can buy a Nestle, I can buy the best businesses. I don't have to buy all the businesses, correct? So, the hurdle rate, sorry?
Or at the wrong time.
So the hurdle rate I keep is, this is my first hurdle rate, ROCE. Now this is the return on the capital employed. The next line is the return on equity, or some people call it return on net worth. Return on net worth is your profit after tax divided by the total shareholder money, the net worth. Okay, so it shows that on the shareholders' money, how much the company earned during the year. Now, this should be more than your bank rate, and this should be logically higher than to me to come into my portfolio. I still need 15. Ideally, I like 25, but 25, if I put, no Indian company comes there. Absolutely no Indian company comes there. So these are the two main things I use as to prepare my shortlist. After that, the rest come. So I can run a program on the whatever system you have and say shortlist those companies with average ROE. I again look at average ROE, not at 1 year, because 1 year can be an error this way or that way, but I look at 10 years. Ideally, I should be looking at longer, but I don't have the resources and the database to go there, because even the balance sheet numbers you get today from standard databases are so corrupt and so wrong. I have a problem. Bloomberg, I can't trust the data, can you believe? The book values are all wrong in that. So these two become my starting point. Okay, sorry.
You mentioned that you look at these two components.
Yes.
But this doesn't tell anything about the cash part of it, cash flows.
No, it doesn't. That's why I explained the free cash flow part of it to you in the beginning, saying I also like to see whether it is cash positive or not. So you want me to go back to that screen?
No. But what I'm saying is that today cash is such an important component, as in, you know, true, these numbers can be fudged or, you know, overstated, like returns. So this may not give us correct picture. Can it be coupled with cash flows and then you filter it out?
No, cash EPS, I tend to use less rather than the free cash flow analysis, because I want to look at change in working capital also. I want to see it cash positive. What I do is, if you are a sophisticated investor, I'll tell you, I like to see free cash flows at least equal to 70% of PAT. Free cash flows. At least 70% of PAT.
Wouldn't you include that as a key parameter?
No, that is not my first cutoff. This is my first. I will make a list. My first elimination will be on this. See, I look at probably about 3 key ratios and about 200 other things. Okay, it's not that this is the only one I look at or I ignore anyone. Okay. Now, which is more important, it depends on your style. What is work for you is fine. Okay, this I am saying is what my selection is. What I do is, my way of selection limits the universe to a very small number. You might miss a lot of opportunities. You will miss companies with no track record because I don't know enough about their background or anything. I can't do an analysis. So if I put in a new company, what I am doing is I am putting venture capital. So I look at it that way, whether I want to punt or not punt. So I look at it that way. So mine is an ultra conservative approach. you will probably make far less money than by going to those fancy PMS managers who give you fabulous returns. I think next issue you will know. There are other things, these are like memorandum information for me, which I start to use to look at my detailed spreadsheet. I just want to look at this return on capital employed, return on net worth, free cash flow. These two things, if I can get across to you, I think you've got more than half your back. Debt equity, I like to look at. I don't like these kind of debt equities. According to me, it's too high. They don't help you to survive a business cycle. 1.5 times, 2 times. Though I think this company goes on the arrogance of its group strength, I think. Anyway, this company is Hindalco Limited, Hindustan Aluminium. The share is trading at 105, 110, and the promoter is so convinced about these numbers that he is putting in 2,300 crores at 150 rupees a share. So he knows something which you and I don't know. See, there are a lot of other checklists I use. The promoter shareholding in this company is very low. It is only about 24 or 26%, something like that, the officially recorded one. In the US, a study was done as to when does the company's performance get better or worse. What they have found out is that when the founding family shareholding drops below 30%, performance gets better and better. Founding families. In India, it's exactly the perverse. It falls below 30 and the company goes to. That means even the Malik ne kutte ko chhod diya. It virtually like that. I'll give you examples. IVRCL, Jyoti Structures, you name the companies where the promoter holdings have dropped. Means they have seen the ship to be sinking. They have sold their shares and got out. So keep a lookout for this. When the shareholding of the promoter drops below 30, it is surely a sign of trouble. Because in India, everybody likes to keep things for their children and grandchildren. There is no question of getting professionals into the business. I think the last one which cheated us was Infosys.
Sir, what is the debt equity limit you prescribe?
I don't prescribe, it is again preferences. See, if the business is such that it gives you very high return on capital employed, then it makes sense to have a high debt equity. Not cyclical. Yes. This is aluminium copper. Yeah. These are two things which he is doing, and he's got captive power generation. These are the three business segments if you might like to choose Hindalco has. So these numbers are not enthusiastic for a large group with so much history. I think the error they made was in the global acquisition. Till then the numbers are not half as bad. So, this does, and look at his capital expenditure also. Each year he's been spending huge amounts, which again leads you to doubt, is that where the money of the promoter comes from to keep buying shares from the market or through private placements? We don't know, because it could be, if you're setting up a power plant, whether it is $2 million or $3 million, we can't figure out anything like that. So ultimately, it all translates into ROCE, return on equity, and then you look at the free cash flows. These three things should give you a fairly strong comfort level. I think anybody who wants to go deeper than that into financial analysis should take a textbook, sit down at home and read. I think these are the main things which I think are not very complex. Maybe free cash flow is, you will have to do it 3-4 times before you get the hang of it. Okay. So once you do that, then at least the return on capital and return, or at least forget return on capital, return on net worth, please, I think, start looking at that. And if you make a table, you will find Hindustan Lever at 50 to 75% per annum. Colgate at over 100%. What it means is, if that company had 1 rupee of shareholders' money at the beginning of the year, in 12 months it had become 2 rupees, 100% ROE. He's doubled that money. Of that, he is giving you back 60% as dividend also. So that's why the prices, I don't understand the prices, so I don't buy them. But every time I keep chasing it, it never comes to the price I want. Yeah.
Sir, in the free cash flow, you also take into account the working capital changes from the capital expenditure?
No, I don't remove the capital expenditure. I take only the working capital expenditure, the changes. What I do is the PBT, whatever is there, to that I add gross current assets minus gross current liabilities. Hmm. So it is actually a change in working capital. Sorry? No, you add the assets. Because assets is where your money is locked in. Liability is where somebody has funded you.
So therefore it actually cash flow.
Sorry? No, your free cash flow from that you deduct the, you're right. You deduct the gross current assets and add the gross current liabilities.
This valuation is taken to about replacement cost. Because somebody is saying,
okay, let me argue that this was, I think, the replacement cost theory. That means if a new plant, cement plant, costs, let's say, 10 rupees, I have a plant at 1 rupee, the 10 rupee fellow won't set it up unless there is profit in that. Otherwise, he is a fool to set it up. He won't compete with me. Now, at that same price, if I sell my product, my profit should be at least 5 times what he is making. So that measure you will see in the return on net worth or the return on capital employed. So don't fall for that trap. But typically, if you see, actually you raised in it, what I do also is, Debu, I look at companies into two categories. One is companies which you value on the basis of profit and loss, and other is companies which you value on the basis of assets and liabilities. Most of these cyclical companies like Hindalco or SAIL or anything, you value it on replacement cost. The assumption is that in a bad cycle, the market penalizes them so much, you get it far below replacement cost. And if you can find something at, let's say, 50% of replacement cost, there is a reasonable hope of making money over the next 3 to 5 years when the cycle recovers. For example, I don't know whether you looked at SAIL recently. It is at 20% of replacement cost. When the cycle does turn, hopefully it should make more money. So that is one. There are companies like a Lever, Nestle, Colgate, which have no assets. So you value them on the basis of the balance sheet, on the earnings. So if you want to actually extrapolate the future of Nestle for the next 10 years, you will be close to 80% correct. What you do is you take this year's profits after tax, put that number there. Then you assume that they will make definitely a 50% return on capital, return on equity every year, because they have never fallen below that, let's assume. So you add to that 50%, from there you pay a little bit of dividend what they have been paying, and you project it same way for 10 years, you will get an approximate number. Then you see at that time what kind of PEs will be there, what kind of return you can get. That's a way to evaluate. But what I mean is, if you are an investor, one is, I presume you have money ready. Two, you will buy only when you like something at the price you want it. It is not something saying that every year I have to put so much money into the stock market. Then that way it doesn't help. Okay, you have your small SIP, that's fine. That will give you your index returns. The index returns could be what, 12%? 12 or 14, nothing more than that. But if you want to go put directly into equities, the only way is you have to do it at your convenience and not when everybody is buying stocks and everybody is shouting about it, because I think at 22,000 everybody will shout again, and that's when you will end up buying. So keep a short list. You don't have to buy 200 stocks, buy 5 stocks. That will create wealth over the long term. Or I think once I had talked about a SIP in 5 good stocks. There you don't even have to do the number work. There you go and say, go to the market, ask your wife to pick up which are the products she likes, she will keep buying for the next 20 years. Pick up those 5 companies and buy, let's say, 1 share each over the next 10 years. you will probably be a winner in that. So the key thing is that you buy it with money which you are not going to need. If you are going to do it with what you have kept for your children's education or your daughter's marriage or something like that, for God's sake, don't keep that money in equities ever. It will not be available. At that time, one more Harshad Mehta comes, it will be on the front pages with Sucheta and Debu writing about it, and that market will go out. So equities is really a bucket into your wealth bucket and not into your savings product. Unless you have a habit that, okay, you are starting very young, you have a fixed income every month, your dad and mom don't want any money from you, then go buying shares. You can take that risk. But most of the people I have seen get into shares only around the mid-30s to early 40s. Till then, they are too busy with their lives and building everything. That time, they start thinking, oh, I miss so much. You know that neighbor, he has 2,000 shares of Colgate. So you start thinking, I should also buy. So the earlier you start, the better it is. I don't see too many young faces here. So, and it's a game of patience. I think you can create a estate. See, my philosophy is not the only philosophy. It may be right, it may be wrong. It's worked for me. That's what I am comfortable with. To me, when I buy stocks, it doesn't mean that I should worry about it every day. I should be able to sleep peacefully. Only then I put money into stocks. I compartmentalize my mind into two things. One is I buy knowingly for the long term. Second one is I pure gamble, like going to the casino. Our friend MCX, at 260 rupees, I said, I'm going to buy. What will happen? My argument went like this. I said, he will probably be deemed to be an unfit and improper person. He will have to sell that company. The business is still viable. And hopefully when one bank has been robbed, the other branch becomes safer. So MCX is a clean place. Somebody will buy it up. I bought the share at 260, let's say. My downside I calculated is 260. So I'm willing to lose that. So that is the other bucket which one I keep in my mind. And that, I don't know when I'll sell. I may sell it at 500, I may sell it at 700. But it's definitely not a for keeps kind of a bucket. So I keep my mind, so I don't sleep. I don't lose sleep on my stocks. Most investors have what is called, very interestingly, it's called the light in the refrigerator syndrome. Most of us suffer from that. It's like at night, suddenly you wake up, hey, that fridge ka light, band hua, open it. Arre, chalo hai. Close. Come after 1 hour, again it's open. So what people do when they buy their first share, next morning before they have their cup of tea, first share price kya hua. Today you don't have to look at the paper, you have a live bhav copy in so many channels. So every time you're looking at it, every time it goes down 2 rupees, and first time you buy it, next 4 days, it's on lower circuit. So don't be into that kind of an attitude, please. And just to complete Hindalco, there are some other things which actually vitiate the ratios dramatically. They have something called goodwill. That means they bought these foreign companies at prices which were at an auction or like bidding, competitive bidding. And then you value the asset. And then you found that there is 15,000 crores of extra money you have paid, which is not yet written off. It is carried as an asset in the goodwill. They will write it off over whatever time. And then the company doesn't tell me how much of the debt is in foreign exchange, so I can't make a measure. But all I know is that it is valued at the end of the year rate. So that means if the rupee is depreciating, I know this figure is higher. And this company is reported book value is 184, and according to me, it's not even 104 rupees. And the foreign exchange, you look at it, they got global companies, global things. I thought they would be foreign exchange neutral. Last year, they used 18,000 crores of forex, and the earning was only 7,500. So this is also going to impact the future earnings in whichever way. So this is what I looked at as Hindalco. To to me it didn't look very appealing. I wouldn't have it in my portfolio, definitely. I have far better choices. But probably the promoter knows a little better, so he's putting this in that. So anything more on financial analysis or ratios on the basics would anybody like to? I don't like to look at PEs at all. See, PE is actually is a function. We looked at return on equity. PE is very close to that. See, return on net worth, let's say, is 8%. What does it mean? 8 on 100. It's a PE of 12.5. So there are different theories on PE, how the PE should be, how much the market should be. Some people say if you think the growth is 15% in the EPS, then you can give a 15 times multiple. Okay, so I don't subscribe to that. I like to buy things when they are cheap, otherwise I'm happy not buying them at all. So there is no great formula. It's a nice measure to explain the market to how expensive or how cheap that is. And when you read in the market that the PE of the market is 15, it's the most misleading thing you can ever think of, because there is a stock like ITC or a Lever or an Infosys which or a TCS which are at 30s and 40s, and the rest of the market will be at 7, 8, 9. So PEs don't really tell you too much. I don't really bother about PE so much.
How much importance should one give to the asset turnover, the debtors turnover, and the working capital cycle, or the return on assets?
See, those are, I think, relevant when you start comparing them with other companies in the industry. Because a company's numbers by itself, you have no basis to judge whether it is above average, below average, or right. Okay, so these three, four ratios you can use only when you compare it. Like if I want to take Hindalco, I'll take it with a Sterlite or somebody like that and see whether those ratios are comparable or not, and then form my conclusions. Because the asset turnover, and typically each industry characteristic is different. If you take an engineering or a manufacturing company, they will have a number of, and the asset turnover will be lower than in a consumer product company, because like Lever, because the fixed asset base is very small and creates a lot of turnover, whereas somebody like a SAIL or a Hindalco, it will not be as high. So these are the general ratios which you will take, but you will use them when you are comparing five companies or three companies in the peer group.
Companies in the same business.
Three
companies, it will be similar.
True. See, the ultimate efficiency, whichever way you say, I have the shiniest steel, I have the best steel, it should translate into the bottom line. So don't get carried away by a lot of hype saying that we have 10,000 outlets, we have 20,000 sales guys. This is the hype which people get carried away with. Ultimately, if you don't make money, because why are you investing? Are you investing out of patriotism or love for somebody? No. You are investing it because you want your money to get you some return. So be hard-nosed about it. Don't get carried away by that. Look at profits, cash, and dividend. I don't like companies which don't pay tax, because that means profits are not what they are. Go for companies which pay tax, they give you dividends regularly. And in India, we will not find very high dividend paying company, because most of them, except for the multinationals, the Indian companies are still in a growing phase. So they need to conserve capital to grow more also. So they will probably have a lower dividend payout ratio. Whereas the multinationals, they are in consumer products, their investment needs are not very high. So they will pay out far more dividend than the other Indian companies.
If I do not have the literacy that you explain, who can I, or where can I turn to know which stocks to pick?
This is a
fundamental question.
See, I understand. This is a dilemma.
Who can I trust?
I think in money matters, don't trust anyone. I would really tell you.
Money life also?
No, but we don't give... specific stuff.
They have
okay.
specific stuff.
But then you follow the discipline which they tell you. He gives his column with specific buys, specific time to sell, follow that. And an annual report of what his stocks has also done. I think you can trust because there is no broking activity here, no merchant banking here, there is no vested axe to grind. And you all don't pay us anything also. No, which is right. I think you follow that. Or if you are doing a monthly buying of stocks in, you are going to pick five stocks, then don't bother too much about which stocks you are looking at. Look at the quality of companies. Look at what products they have. That is one way to buy. But I think this is a good recommendation. But then make sure you make it a regular habit to read about that company, what he is saying every fortnight, and follow that advice. Sometimes he'll tell you that I made a wrong call, so but get out. So don't stick to the thing. There are a lot of people who are like the old LIC of India. If I bought at 100 rupees, I cannot sell below 100. They have that, and that is where everybody goes wrong. We all make mistakes. I think everyone makes mistakes. So, but I think the average has been phenomenal in MoneyLife's recommendations on stocks. And I think they are more tailor-made for individuals than institutions, to the extent that you can actually implement those ideas, because I'm sure none of you are going to buy 50 lakhs of each stock.
Trending and those so-called intellectual people, you all focused on these running scripts which are there on TVs and displayed on their phones and smartphones. So you all see this. So the education about how do you do is something which is perceived as, okay, I know it and I want to share it. It's not about being, saying what they
do. No, for that I think you have to take your things in your hand. If you are spending so much time on your job or your hobby, this is ultimately your money, isn't it? Shouldn't you keep aside an hour to hour a week to study about what you do with your money? Can't you do that?
There's no correct guidance.
No, not correct. There are magazines, there are books which give you some basic thing, but you're not going to become, see this, I have been doing this for a living for 25, 30 years.
Yes.
And still I am learning. There's still no completion to that. So I'm not saying everybody will get this, or I am giving you some checkpoints to guide that. I cannot coach anybody because I am not a qualified coach or anything like that. And to do that, we have to sit one-on-one across the table. I'll give you five balance sheets. Le bhaiya entry mar, data entry karo. 5 saal ka, there will be 40,000 data entry points. Would somebody be able to do it? That is the passion needed to come out with all these things. What I can share, or Debu or the magazine can share, is our experiences, some kind of checkpoints, checklists, and based on our thing and in good faith, I think the recommendations come. There is a method which is used, and ultimately he measures the return each year and gives it to you. Most newsletters or magazines, they never talk about a recommendation afterwards. No broker talks about what happened to his recommendations of last year. Correct? So to that extent, you got a helping hand here. So what you got to do is, first is stop watching CNBC and Times, whatever that, Times Now, Times Later, whatever that thing is. And stop reading Economic Times. Then I think you read serious books. I think that then that will give you that 1 hour in a day. Read some good books, basic books. There are some books which you can come here, sit and read without your spouse bothering you. You can come here, sit and read peacefully. There's a library for all MoneyLife Foundation members.
Just one more question. We are those who are not very experienced and literate, financially literate, are advised to invest through mutual funds.
I think that
into
is
equity. But then, right at the start of your speech, you said something and that made me very nervous. You said your friend who was a fund manager, he invested because his broker had told him.
No, but you see, the mutual funds have a peculiar problem. They cannot pick and choose at their time and will. They get a flow of money. They have to put it into the market. And they typically get most money when the stocks are the costliest. That's because of what we all do.
Yes.
Okay. But it's not that every fund manager is bad. There are some good funds also. I think look at the 3 or 5 which I think in MoneyLife we analyze them and carry those funds. I think those are good funds, and we don't take a one-day view. It is a long-term view which is taken on the past. Though I think the past is not the best way, but it gives you something about the style and consistency of that fund. I'm sure there are funds like Templeton or Quantum. These are great funds. They will give you the market returns. Direct equities is where you are taking a higher level of risk, hoping that we will get a higher return.
So fund managers can be trusted?
I would think so. I think the system is decent. But don't go for things like sector funds and the new fashion. And if you are going to put 10,000 rupees in a month, put it in one or two funds. Don't go to 14 funds. I have seen some individuals having 60 folios, which even a fund doesn't have. They have 2 clerks employed to calculate their own NAVs every day.
So, based on these ratios, do you have any spreadsheet which tells us how these ratios translate into a right level of price, assuming that we don't apply P ratio, since you believe in P ratio?
Well, that is, I think, very professional level counseling. But typically, you can use this kind of a ratio. What I'll say is, if the return on net worth, let's say, is average, is let us say 50%. So, let us say the average, the fair price today should be more or less about 6 to 7 times book value. Okay. So, that is a kind of fair value if I get. If I want excess return, what do? I buy it when it is 4 times book value. Maybe if the market provides me something like that, I'll buy time like that. Like in my last issue, we wrote about NHPC, National Hydropower Corporation. The stock was at 16, book value was 22, and it had a 2 rupees plus earnings. I thought it was an attractive buy. It will not go from 16 to 160 definitely. But if it goes from 16 to 25, we have a good return. So there you can follow some thumb rules like that. See, the basic thing is the professional investor or the fund manager, or what I think the recommendations which will come to you from MoneyLife, they go into more complexities into estimating the future. There are several metrics which come in, and with the knowledge of promoters and the business, I think the bad ones are automatically weeded out. So it does come. I don't think you can, for example, there's a company which I consult with. They have a complex model which in which they have a price band which they think is the fair band, price band for each company. So they will have a range. For Hindalco, let's say the range they will put is 60 to 80. They'll say the worst it can go to is 60, the best it can go to is 80, if they think. So they will say the closer to 60, I am a buyer. Closer to 80, I am a seller. So that's one way to fix a band and do like that. But that will need far more complex analysis than what I have shown you. I can only show you a simple model of using the debt security as a proxy. And it is very difficult to find stocks at that price. Very rare. This is something which I just thought I'll share with you. Can everybody read it?
Yeah.
This company kept on doing all the things which I mentioned here. It's actually a non-performing assets, but the banks have a problem with, because the magnitude of the loan is so large that it will hit their bottom line, so they have kept it as a standard asset. Okay? Those guidelines keep changing. And another thing, all I do as a bank manager, all I do is I tell them, you fund your interest, bhaiya, I'll give you a separate loan in another company, fund your interest. It becomes a standard asset.
And then restructure.
Okay. Sorry?
Then restructure.
Restructure. This is not restructured yet. Okay. And this promoter made an announcement of a foreign investor coming in and taking a stake, and promptly sold his own stake, reduced by 5%. It's not a small company. Market cap is 32,565 crores. The net worth they calculated is negative 1,827 crores. His debt is 11,900 crores on the balance sheet. Off balance sheet is 9,500 crores. His total assets, 18,000 crores. Earnings, one day he will hopefully make money. Auditor, Deloitte Haskins and Sells. Bankers, total assets, he's got cash 9,200 crores. His forex is unhedged, his loans. This is the kind of operating cash flow was last year, 8,700 crores loss. He is already in default. He is talking to banks and the term lenders to extend maturities. And he had to do revaluation of his assets to show a healthier picture than what he was. And he has not recognized his forex losses, saying that he will charge them when he repays the loan, which means he has no intention to repay probably. And he revalued land, and that land is not something which he can sell because he needs it to continue his operations and his business. So whatever value you put for it is notional, correct? Then he then whatever accounting liberals he can do, he has done that. And the auditors have also not done any impairment or anything like that. He's got investments in other things and other businesses and everything. He's got goodwill. And he was also a very smart fellow. Let me tell you, this is Jet Airways.
If any company has revaluated its asset, then you should not go anywhere near that.
No, in the old days, a lot of them used to do. Yeah. But today, I think you should knock it off. What he also did was, when you today call Jet, the number for booking, it goes to a call center. Originally, that call center was inside the company. It was company employees. What he did, he has now outsourced it to a company which belongs to himself, his wife, and that is paid market rates. So that if it was in the company as such is in a loss, so he would have got nothing out of it. So now there is a call center business which feeds off, and he takes money away from there also. So how many businessmen you know that who do ancillary businesses out of the listed company? They will have selling agencies, buying agencies.
Is it market related?
No, how does it matter is, if it was inside the company, it would have been at cost. One, there would have been no profit in that. And two, the promoter would not have made any surplus on that because the company is in a loss. Now by taking this outside, he is actually dipping into your pocket and taking something out.
It's an expense they're paying.
Yes.
Salaries, and then ultimately the premium is.
Salaries, it will not, it means cost plus. That plus goes to him, no?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, don't we have such norm like our company?
Don't we have a company act which got revised, and don't we have anything which can?
No,
do something
no,
for
can,
the...
No, this is all disclosed in the balance sheet.
Fantastic.
It only says with key management personnel. It doesn't tell you it is Mrs. Goyal or somebody like that.
So
we happen to know because of whatever reasons.
So won't there be a law, or can't the law be so stringent to make...
No. See, the law is always in favor of capital markets. See, the biggest source of greed has always been the capital markets. 75% of disputes in India are because of land. And worldwide, all the frauds have happened mostly driven by capital markets. Because see, today the promoter or the businessman, entrepreneur has realized that in the old days, I would take 1 crore out of a 100 crore company, to mera paisa jeb mein aata tha. But that was 1 crore. Today he says, if I keep it in the company as profit, my shares are worth so much more. So everybody is playing the capital market game. In the West, the bonuses, the performance, everything is dependent on the quarterly performance. So everything goes into manipulating the books. And who becomes a regulator, either a civil servant in India or an ex-banker in the US? So all of them are part of the game. There is an old saying that it's Wall Street that writes the rules. There is a wonderful film people must see. It's called Untouchables. Which one? I'm not talking about the Robert De Niro or the old one, 83 ka film. This is a film made last year. It has people like, brilliant people like Mike Milken or Bernie Madoff, and there are so many others who get away virtually without anything. Madoff is the only one who's got some kind of a punishment in a five-star jail. But white-collar criminals get away so easily. See, how much are we fighting? And everyone gets away. But 3 saal mein wo aa jayega bahar. But these are all high profile. But Goldman Sachs, nobody has been touched. Morgan Stanley, everybody is still around. Everybody is around.
So you're, these laws,
no, the let, no, this is it's a make-believe. You have to, they have a nice circle of brokers, lawyers, fund managers, everything. You have to keep the circle going.
Rating so, agencies.
So in this, so as an investor, you're fighting so many people. So.
The investors in the US got their money back because of class action. We now have class action possible over here. But as I keep pointing out, nobody gets together. Today you have NSCL. So we have hundreds of those people who go to protest in BMWs and Mercedes. But when it comes to fighting, they want MoneyLife to fight. Okay? They will not spend a penny. They will not get together. But they want somebody else to fight their battle. In India, we've had one person who's been fighting. We've had somebody called Viren Jain of the Midas Touch Investors Association. And after the Harshad Mehta scam, he filed a case on CanBank Mutual Fund, the CanStar case. Okay, I think lakhs of people got their money back, not only from CanStar, but all the public sector mutual funds which had made assured returns. I don't think one person has written to him to say thank you
also.
And the next time when he filed a case in Satyam, he was again spending his own money. Nobody wants to contribute $200 to a fight. And then we sit here and say, what can be done? Nothing can be done. We set up MoneyLife Foundation exactly for this. People come here and tell us. So ICICI supports it. If ICICI didn't, and they give us the freedom to say what we want to over here, that's why you're able to listen to people like Bala. Now the fact is that people who have the money and who want somebody to fight, they want that somebody to fight. And they only want to come here with a complaint, not ever join in either to file a memorandum or to help out with anything else. Those are so few. I don't think there are more than 20 people who come here and say, I would like to help.
No, there I think, Sucheta, capitalism again the best response. If you look at the US, why the class action suits work? Is because of the ambulance chasing lawyers. They work on a percentage basis, saying that we will file this class action suit, 30% is mine.
But you know, Bala, that also will not work in India, because if cases go on for 15 years,
you don't
have ambulance chasing lawyers. They will keep taking money.
They want fees in advance.
For every appearance, they will want you to pay.
True.
So you then need judicial reforms.
The lawyers are willing to invest time, and because they know the judicial system is fast enough.
Exactly.
So every kind of, see, profit on sale and lease back. Now, what is a sale and lease back? Do people understand?
Yeah.
So for people who are not in finance or don't know this, I will just tell you. It's like I today need money. So I take this pen, come to you. I say, you give me 100 rupees against this. So I borrow 100 rupees from you. I sell it to you for 100. Then you give it back to me on an EMI basis. So I have leased it from you. But this pen cost me 0. Okay, what I have done is I actually taken a loan of 100. But accounting wise, what I do is this pen cost me 0. I sold it to you for 100. So I record a profit of 100 rupees. This is what sale and lease back transactions are used for. Then he sold landing rights from A company to B company, showed a profit on that. This was, I think, the one which is sold to Etihad, I think. So every kind of thing, and this is all recorded in the balance sheet. I have not done any investigative journalism or anything like that. This is there all in the public record. And all the institutional investors go and buy these stocks. So essentially I am saying that financial analysis is only one tool to help you. There are, and financial analysis, there will be very few companies which will pass 100% of the test. Very few companies, I can tell you. So the more important thing is to know about promoters, know about the business a bit. If you don't understand something, don't buy it, I would always say. And be aware of what you're doing with your money. If you're going to put it in stocks, be prepared for long waits. Don't put your money which you need to buy your car, your house, or fund your child's education or marriage. Don't use it with equities. I know what I am saying means you will go back to your fixed deposit or something where you actually might lose principal because of inflation, but there is no other way to fight. I get mails from people who can save 10,000 rupees a month, and he says in 3 years he wants it to become 25 lakh to fund his daughter's marriage. I said, I don't know of any financial instrument, but I can suggest one thing. Take a ticket from Air Asia, it goes to Kuala Lumpur. From there, take a taxi to Genting Highland. There's a casino there. If you make, your problem is solved. If you don't, you would have had a good time. Otherwise, you will go to some financial advisor and he will tell you, sir, this stock is good, or put it in NACL or something like that, and lose that. Better than that, you would have had fun. So don't have unrealistic expectations. And if you're doing financial planning, as I always talk in the thing, I think start with your resources and then define your goals. If you define your goals first, then the financial planner will invent instruments to take your money.
And I had another question for you, since you are from the rating agency.
Mm-hmm.
USA was brought down by this derivatives.
Sorry? Yeah.
Now, these derivatives must have been rated. Because without rating, the financial institutions cannot purchase them or sell them. So, who are the rating agency and what punishment they have got?
They have been getting punished, but I think more important, I think they have been getting away because of the legal system and the opinion framework in which they operate.
They have got away completely, you know, so far.
Sorry?
So far, none of them has gone to jail.
No, now Standard & Poor's, because they downgraded the US from AAA to AA+, they have been slapped with a suit by the government for a $5 billion damages for what they did. That's happened. In fact, there is an independent rating agency which has come up in the US. There are two actually, which don't take money from the rated companies. They take money from the investors. The one is called Rapid Ratings, which I really value. They have done about 4,000 instruments, and they called Enron about a year before the other agencies. I think they have been fairly good. So those kind of models, I think, if it comes in India, that will be good. I think rating agencies, by and large, on the corporate ratings, bond ratings, they have been okay. Structured finance is where I think they all messed up. By saying that if there are 10 bad apples, it is equal to 2 good apples.
Okay, I think that was the last question. We come to the end of our session. We must all give Bala a very big hand. Thank you, Bala, very much.